Reentry is a public safety issue. Everyone can agree that we must maintain safe and secure prisons, provide thoughtful supervision to those who are releasing. But in order for the department to fulfill its mission of working together for safer communities, it is increasingly imperative to prepare those individuals for transition to the community. This imperative should not just be felt by those releasing from incarceration, but rather by the public and those agencies entrusted to serve the public. Last year, DOC released approximately 8,000 people from confinement. And we know that all points of transition pose some level of risk. We spend a lot of time and effort assessing that risk as folks move within the system. But it wasn't until recently that the department dedicated some additional resources toward mitigating the risks associated with release. And with a 32% rate of recidivism, we needed to do something. And we have invested in the last 2 years that the reentry unit, now division, has existed. We've invested a lot of time and energy having conversations and putting some practices in place to assist with reentry. Our division is charged with building a statewide approach to recidivism reduction. Our division has 13 work releases located throughout Washington, a housing voucher program. We provide veteran services, and we have several case managers and transition specialists carrying out the work of two very large federal grants. Just this week, we are launching a request for proposal that will allow the Department of Corrections to potentially entertain more work releases, or at least to see who out there in the community is willing to provide work release services. Just in this legislative session, we were able to testify in support of a Senate bill that allows us to pilot the use of providing housing vouchers. Housing vouchers provide up to 3 months housing assistance upon release. This legislation would allow us to pilot vouchers for people releasing without community supervision. Traditionally, the department really only invests in those folks who have community supervision upon release, and this is a significant gap for us. Through our Second Chance Act reentry grant, we've been able to build a strong network of community stakeholders to design and implement a reentry model that includes both in-reach and aftercare for those transitioning from prison to the community. The project's case management approach is rooted in the principles of risk management, needs, and individual response. Using our transition specialists as a primary point of contact, participants are designing their own reentry plans, including education, treatment, help with family reunification, medical assistance, housing, employment, and other needs while in custody. And then through that group, they're being connected to those services upon release and through community supervision. Today, this work is centered out of the Monroe Correctional Complex and Seattle-based work releases. However, we are in the process of expanding this work to the Washington Correction Center for Women, Mission Creek Correction Center for Women, and Irway Heights Correction Center. And to aid in our work, to aid in this work specifically in Pierce County, we have two work releases in Pierce County. We have just recently assigned a transition specialist to help coordinate that work in Pierce County. We're also in the middle of a 5-year grant from the Administration of Children and Families that serves incarcerated fathers. This program provides support for positive parenting, healthy relationships with partners and co-parents, and economic stability. The program includes a combination of classes and case management for incarcerated fathers up to 9 months before release and 6 months after release. And there really is a theme about both before release and after release for reentry to be successful. Currently, this program is being offered in the Washington Correction Center, Larch Correction Center, Cedar Creek Correction Center, and Stafford Creek Correction Center. With both of these grants, it is our desire, and we're in the process of building a framework that would allow the Department of Corrections to sustain this work beyond the grant dollars. And this last year was an important year for reentry. President Obama proclaimed the last week in April National Reentry Week. Washington formed the Statewide Reentry Council, comprised of 15 members from a variety of disciplines, including those with incarceration experience. Governor Inslee created Executive Order 1605, building safe and strong communities through successful reentry. And it is through that executive order that we are in the process of creating a reentry orientation as you come into our system so that you can plan through your incarceration the things that you will do and the things to take advantage of, as well as when you get out of the system. We're doing a lot with our federal grants, but as part of the federal grants, we are also working to build a system that would allow us to sustain this work once the grant monies run out. And that really is the fate of reentry through years past, is there's a lot of enthusiasm, and then the pendulum swings. And we're trying to build an infrastructure that would prevent that from happening. Through the governor's executive order on reentry, we are also working to provide important documents upon release, such as education transcripts, employment certifications or resumes, and medical information. And we are working with Department of Licensing, and in fact, just this morning, I testified in support of Senate Bill 5558 to actually provide Washington State licenses to people as they release from prison. You've all heard the stories of people just get sent out with a prison ID. They have to pay $54 if they get to a DOL. This would prevent all of that. It's a two-year ID card that the Department of Corrections or the releasing individual would pay for if they chose to. And it would be handed to them upon release. And we have a companion bill in the House on that as well. And that's actually agency request legislation. Obtaining a valid ID card is one of the cornerstones of successful reentry. Identification is needed to access housing, treatment, and employment. Providing a Washington State identification as people leave prison makes sure that they're better prepared to seek employment, but also removes that stigma of having to walk into a Department of Licensing with a prison ID. And we're expanding the conversation. So in the last year, we've had a series of what we've coined Hope Cafes. But really, this is following the World Cafe model, and it's bringing the conversation around recidivism to the incarcerated men and women, to men and women who are on supervision, to our community partners, to families of those who are incarcerated, and really having the conversation about what contributes to recidivism. That work is continuing today, and you can find information on that, I think, on our website, as well as we have a process for analyzing that information so that we can then work to address those issues that have been identified. Every employee in the Department of Corrections can tell you how their job links to reentry. And I've highlighted some of the work of the Reentry Division, but it is by far not the only good work of the Department of Corrections that is taking place. As a division, we work very closely with correctional industries, our largest reentry program, our education and health services, and our offender change division. Each one of those just named have navigators or specialists working to coordinate care from prison to the community. We are also working with other state agencies to coordinate care upon release. One such example includes working with DSHS to pre-screen or qualify certain individuals for benefits upon release. And just this week, we had a meeting with the Social Security Administration to formalize and operationalize an agreement for pre-release services. There is much the Department of Corrections is doing to improve reentry and transition processes today. Some of these strategies are immediate, and some are building blocks for a stronger reentry-focused future. I hope that this information is helpful. I would like to extend an opportunity to visit any one of our prisons or work releases, and I do have business cards if you're interested in that, as well as being able to attend a Hope Cafe. Thank you. The question was, what legislation would I like to see? Not necessarily what's taking place today, but what would I like to see to aid in reentry? And there are two significant issues that stand out. And one is legal financial obligations and the compounding interest that occurs with those. I would also like to see, and this is in place, but less opportunities for discrimination against those people who have served time in prison. That can come in the form of a ban the box, that can come in the form of housing. There's a tremendous amount of discrimination and stigma that comes with just having served time in prison. So I would definitely go after areas that would reduce that.
Another thing that I'm curious if you could speak to for us, in your positions and with your place with the DOC, what type of community and individual supports would best fuel or further the efforts that are being made on a grand scale?
Those are great questions. There are a lot of community organizations, and certainly just in our work in King County and Pierce County, we've learned of the passion around reentry in general. One such organization that is all over Washington is the Community Partnership for Transition Services. And that is comprised of anybody who wants to be a member. There are several folks who have experienced incarceration, but also those in businesses who are willing to hire those who have been incarcerated. Any community member really that wants to get passionate about reentry. So that's one such organization. I would also invite that the Department of Corrections is working to have a larger presence in the community in the forms of meetings and information sessions. And so to that extent, when we are out in the communities and having conversations, we would want to hear from our neighbors, our communities that we serve.
I would like to invite Heidi and Abram up to join us here at the table. They are both so very brave to present with us today, and we're very grateful for their willingness to share their experiences with us.
Okay, I hope this isn't against the rules, but I'm going to lose this mic, kind of like getting free from prison. Anyway, my name is Heidi, and I'm going to stand up and just have a conversation with you. So this is my first invitation to something like this. I've not spoken before, so I'm going to warn you there might be tears, but that's just because I'm emotionally still processing these things. So don't be scared of my tears, and I'll keep talking through them, but I'm very passionate about this, and it affects me deeply, so therefore that's just what happens. Okay, so they asked me to talk about my reentry experience from the moment I got out on. So what you should know is that I got out in June 25th, 2009. That was 6 days after my 35th birthday. So I spent my late 20s and my early 30s incarcerated. I was down, call it down, I was down 7 years. So between time in jail and then actually moving to prison, 7 years. So now I'm actually, ironically enough, at the 7 year out mark. So it's this weird time of I've been down as long as I've been out and just the reality of that. I want to tell you the story of the day I got out. So you know that you have a date set in your head, right? You get these little journals and you mark, just like in all the movies, little X's through all the days left till you get out. That's goofy. That's just what you do. But that's what you hope for. That is your hope that keeps you going, right? So then the day comes and there's so many things that go wonky in DOC. You don't really believe you're getting out until certain things happen. And one of those markers is there's a program called the Clothing Closet. Chapel Hill, over in Gig Harbor, takes in donations, and then they give you two outfits for when you get out. Like, my family was able to send me clothing inside. I don't know if that still exists. But just the moment of getting a new pair of shoes, used ones even, it was just a moment of telling me that I was somebody, I was valuable, and we're going to put my best foot forward getting out, because it can be kind of freaky to get out. You know, this is your comfort zone. This is what you've known. You've heard stories of people getting out of, like, prisons, and that's what you knew. So you're like, do I have to go? Do I have to get? I mean, it's weird that you have those thoughts. Of course you want to go and be with your family, but you still kind of look back. So it's this, that stuff has to be transitioned out of. That's what we're talking about, giving people the ability to go, yes, I was there, I'm headed here, and how do I navigate that? So I know I'm getting out because I got my clothes. They give me my $40 cash. I don't know if that's changed. They give you $40 cash, which now would not be enough to get your driver's license. I had a list of 10 things, and they weren't like going to Rome or, you know, getting on a ferry. It was just like, go to the grocery store. How cool for my choice to be restored. I could go to the grocery store and I could choose which peanut butter I wanted to have. It was like this cool, I don't know, that was the coolest to me. I call it phase one of my reentry. Everything is wondrous. If I had to come into this building, I'd be like, oh, look at those cool frames and the drapes. And it just your sense of of life is heightened. Your senses, everything you're hearing is heightened, which also meant that if I was in a room with a bunch of people, it was very hard for me. I'm a vibrant person. I have personality. But being in a room with people was like, I'm just going to go, I would literally go stand over here at the wall and I just wished I could just disappear. That was a function of getting out and learning to be in a room and functioning with people again. Okay, so I'm not making a very good chronological argument here, but so I get out. You could only have 5 people in the lobby, so I have my immediate family, but then the rest of my family is waiting in a parking lot because the rule is you have to leave the facility, you can't stay. So I go to the parking lot, because at that point you're really scared that they're still going to, you've heard stories of them still coming at that point in the lobby and going, oh, whoops, the paperwork got messed up and you have to go back in. So it's like this psychological, okay, once I'm off the grounds, they are releasing me, it is my release date. I greet my family. I have 2 children. My children were 2 and 4 when I went in. They are now 9 and 11. Things have changed. I have a list of things that were invented when I was down. iPods, YouTube, DirecTV did not exist when I went in, and I come out to DirecTV. Can I just say culture shock? People, I didn't even know how to run the digital cameras that they were using to take my picture. I'm like, what is this thing? I'm dealing with culture shock. Everything around me, different cars, everything looks different. There's so many things bombarding my sensory. So the one thing I want to say before it escapes my mind is I was on community custody. I had to check in for another 1.5 years, but they never asked me how I was emotionally doing. It was, can you pee in this cup? Is your pee clean? Are you getting a job? Are you looking for a job? But they never asked me, how are you doing? They never said, do you need therapy? Would you like to see a counselor? I would have really benefited from that, especially with children. And, you know, I had lots of support. I was armed with 5 people that came to the lobby and a parking lot full of people that wanted to see me when I got out. There was no shortage of people that were ready to shore up beside me and hold up the frame of my life while I figured this out. But not everybody has that. And I had that, and it was so hard for me dealing with the emotional part of it, the psychological part. You are affected psychologically after somebody telling you when you will eat, what you will eat. Then you go out and you're like, decisions are still very difficult for me. I sometimes drive around and can't make up my mind if I should take this freeway or this freeway because decisions still come very, I just call it a ramification from prison. Maybe therapy would help that and maybe you guys could recommend somebody. But those were just one of the things that I dealt with. I had a car, the blessing of the independence that a car, I don't know if people think about those things, but my grandma had got diagnosed with Alzheimer's. My aunt and uncle were willing to drive the car from Colorado, and then somebody that didn't even know me gave me $3,500 so I could buy a car. The gift of love from people in my community was what helped me survive. They didn't even know me. They knew I was incarcerated. They knew I was just getting out of prison, but they didn't judge me. One of the most beautiful moments was when I had to go to the Washington driver's license office. I had my $40. My daughters are clung to my side. I mean, they're not. They're going straight up to the counter with me. They're not letting me go. It's a big day. And I have to give the guy my ID, and he's wondering why my license has expired and why I haven't had a license. I have to give him that ID. Oh, that's a tough moment. I'm giving you this because I just got out of prison, and I have the stamp of felon on my head, and I don't feel worthwhile, and I don't feel valued. And he looks at me and goes, meh, and he waves the fee, like you're supposed to take a test and pay this big fee, and he takes care of it, and he just gives it to me. And I just remember that meaning so much to me about my value, and that it was going to be okay, and that things could be restored. I don't know why it spoke so big to me, but it did. Oh, what else do I want to tell you? There's so many things I want to tell you. I was on community custody for 1.5 years. Bad system. It definitely needs to be reworked. Like I said, they didn't ask about my emotional, psychological. They just wanted to know if I peed clean. But there's a whole lot more to getting out. Um, and and it was just a little wonky system. I was assigned to a person, and every 2 months, that person changed. How are they supposed to get to know me? How are they supposed to get to know my needs as me as an individual when they're changing every 2 months? So I had to restart the story all over again. It's painful, people. I don't really want to share the story. I have to restart the whole get to know somebody, have them treat me like a human. And some of them, they do a power trip, and they're power tripping. Some of them were gentle and wanted to help, and they were sincere. But there were people that were not very nice. And so I'm getting through a year and a half of on custody. What else do I want to tell you? Oh, one of the things I was prepared with is DOC has a job hunters class. So they have a book on how to write your resume and what to say, because you don't really have a job history. The biggest barrier to me getting out, even at 7 years, is my housing and my job. I still have to say I'm a felon. Oh, am I going over? I have to say I'm a felon every single time. When is the right moment to bring up that you're a felon and that you've been down for 7 years and that's why you have no job history? It was a friend of the family that gave me my first job. God bless him, gave me my first job. I was a little wobbly. I mean, I answered the phone. I was a little wobbly. It took a little, you had to care about me a little bit to get me through the first few working months. I had a cosmetology license from WCCW. That was going to be my ticket to the real world. But the reality said I had to work evenings and nights. And by goodness, I was not leaving my children. They were going to be number one and priority. And not everybody has that luxury. They can't pick and choose that. They're forced into a certain job or take the first job because those fines are so large. You have to immediately start paying them. So I had the luxury of waiting 6 months, making my children priority. I still got my cosmetology license, but boy, it was hard. The other thing I conquered is UW. I got my BA from UW. I don't know if you can tell, but I'm an educated person. But I didn't want to do it. Do you know how many times I self-sabotaged the decision to walk down there? I had a mentor, one of the community people that come into the prison and minister, do grief and loss counseling, teach a preparedness for getting out. They don't really talk about it. There was two programs. I hope there's a whole lot more. I'm excited that you're even talking about it. This is great. Two programs. Not everybody could get in. 8,000 women. You know what I mean? The number game is very, we have work release, but it only holds 52 people. You know what I mean? So the numbers game is, it doesn't match the amount of people incarcerated. So I lost my train of thought, except for to say that she was assigned me as a mentor because I went to that release program with my mom to talk about how much is rent, where will you sleep, what are the expectations, when are you going to get a job? So there wasn't this fear. We expelled the fear with the conversation before I get out. I was assigned a mentor. She had to physically walk me into UW, or I probably would have never filled out the application. It was just daunting. It just felt like this really big thing that I couldn't accomplish myself. So I would say mentoring, if you could just shore up beside somebody and just walk them to the door. It's not really that complicated. It's just willingness to walk them. As landlords, be willing to give them their first place to live without history. My options with children for a safe place to live at a reasonable amount is nothing. I had to live with my mom way longer than I wanted to because I didn't have any other options. I moved in with a man because I didn't have any other options. Bad things for me, bad choices, and I had to live with the consequences. I'm now on my own. I have an excellent corporate job in a national company because somebody gave me a chance. Be willing to give them a chance. You have the power to start their history over again. Okay. Thank you.
All right, Abram.
Mind if I use that microphone?
Sure.
I want to see everybody.
Hello. All right, can you guys hear me? Okay. Can you hear me in the back? All right. Okay. My name is Abram Potts. Up to just about 4 years ago, I literally spent half my life in prison. I've been to juvenile facilities. I've been to state facilities. My last facility I was in, United States Penitentiary, USP Florence, Max. I came home, 2013. I didn't know nothing. I thought I was prepared physically and mentally. I thought I was prepared, and I was. I came out gunning. I came out running so much to where they literally changed the guidelines. They told me, oh, you got to get your ID, your birth certificate. You got to get a job. You got to get this within 6 months. I did it in one because I wanted it. DOC came to me with a stipulation. Oh, you owe us 1 month. You were 1 month before your release off of probation, before you were to get off. Mind you, I spent majority of that time locked up. Majority of my time I spent locked up on probation. And DOC still came to me talking about, you owe us 1 month. So you need to get a county-to-county pass in order to keep your job. But, oh, you're doing so good. Excuse me for what I'm about to tell you, but I said, hey, if I'm doing so good, what's the stipulation for? Why do I need a stipulation? I got up and I walked out the office. I said, if you're going to get it, get it. But you're not going to stop what I'm about to do now. You held me down too long. I held myself down too long. So with that being said, I was offered a beautiful opportunity now, and I took it. And I'm going to give my life to take that opportunity. I got a pre-apprenticeship fully paid to a place called AJAC, Aerospace Joint Apprenticeship Committee. With this, I became the first person to graduate. It was a pilot class. They didn't know what was going to happen. I took that. With the blessings, I got a job. Then there was a man who believed in me, seen something in me. I got a full ride to a full apprenticeship. Cool. I'm home now. But I still got to face everything else. I got to get a place. I got a job. But I got to get back and forth to work. I'm up at 3 in the morning, hightailing it across the park every single morning to get to Seattle. Still with a stipulation on me. And still saying, hey, man, I'm not letting you take nothing from me. Nothing. This is 2013. It's 2017 year right now. I'm about to graduate. I'm 1 year away from graduating. It's the first thing I've ever done in my life. Now, they gave me outstanding apprentice. I'm out of graduation speaking at Boeing. I got outstanding apprentice. I literally broke down and started crying. I cried like a kid, like my youngest son. But see, this is the thing though. When you come home and you want something, you gotta say, hey man, excuse what I'm about to say, y'all. Excuse my language. You gotta say, this, I'm not letting you take nothing else from me ever again, ever. That's the mentality I had when I came home. And I was used to that attitude then. Because anything that they did in prison, I did the opposite. You say, hey man, we can't do this. No, I'm doing that. Reason being, I refuse. I refuse to be tagged. I refuse to be labeled. I refuse to be anything. To saying, hey, I'm a felon. I'm a criminal. I'm this, I'm that. No, I'm not. I'm a man. I'm a person. I'm a human being. So with that being said, I had a lot of people behind me because they see my drive. I kept going. I kept going. I kept pushing. I seen that I had some old stuff in my history that I needed to take care of, and I went and took care of that. These LFOs. Let me tell you about an LFO in Tacoma. They say an LFO in Tacoma is a legal financial obligation that you have to pay back. Mentally, I was ready, I thought. But when they tell you, oh, you got interest, and you say, hold on, man, interest? Where did interest come from? I got a debt to pay. I want to pay my debt. I'm an upstanding citizen. I'm a person of society. They want to garnish a check. Luckily for me, I worked so much overtime, I had enough money to pay my bills 3 months ahead of time. But then they start garnishing your check. Then they want to say, oh, we're doing you a favor because we're going to put you at this bill right here. How you doing me a favor when you're going to put me at a certain bill and say something when the county's not even getting the money? Y'all paying the money. I'm paying the money. However, mentally, where does this put you at? An ex-felon, when theoretically you're used to going left, but now you're going right. And just like she said, the roadblocks that come ahead with that. What people don't know is this, when you come home out of prison, I know for me, I came out of a max. The sense of touch was uncommon. The violence, you're used to it. I had to get it out of my head. People, I'm scared of them, or I was at the time. It took myself to enroll myself into counseling to say, hey man, I have a problem. There's something right not there. To this day, I still go there every week. Every week I go there. I make sure I'm there front and center, and I make sure I pay my money for it. What little bit I do got here, man, have this, because I'm gonna fix me no matter how long it takes. The point I'm making is this. Start looking at the after effects. Start looking at the effects of what it does to a person. Can't everybody handle this? Everybody mentally can't handle it. Mm-hmm. Only a certain few can. Mm-hmm. By the blessings of God, I'm one of them. Mm-hmm. You tell me, oh, you serve your time, you come back home, be a productive person in society, this is what can happen. But no, that's not what happens. When I speak to juveniles and I look at them, I see me. I spoke to a juvenile last week who said, man, I'm about to leave. I said, where are you going? He said, I'm going to Wenatchee. What are you going there for? To work. But what this little man don't know is this, is that you got a felony. And they saying it's 7 to 10 years before you can go get you a real job. Unless you go to trade school. And half the time, that's even hard because who got $180 to pay per quarter? We're not even talking about the $200 for the books, and that's a used book. But luckily for him, he's an AJAC. Luckily for him, he's an AJAC, and they give him a full ride. And this little man that I'm trying to reach right now, and I'm telling him, I just talked to him yesterday. I said, man, no matter what the stipulations they put in front of you, no matter what they do, you keep moving forward. You don't stop. Because there's going to be a lot of roadblocks when you try to go right. DOC, they don't help. I remember being on DOC. You mean to tell me it's okay to come to a man's house with all this stuff on in front of his kids? What example was that setting? What example was that setting? That's not setting an example. That's setting, letting the world know this person is a criminal, this person is wrong, and we need to treat him like nothing. That's wrong. It's not right. Now, she brought up some good issues. And every one of those issues, I stood up for. Every one. I'm not going to discredit nothing. But at the same time, though, I know a lot of them don't work. I know that for a fact. I know the stipulations that they have for you to take these programs. When I came home to Tacoma, I cried. I'm from Tacoma. I'm from the south side of Tacoma. Raised on 23rd Street, and I cried when I came home because I seen the people. I seen the people in my hometown with this look in their faces. It don't matter if you're from the south side, the east side, the west, wherever, I seen the look in their faces. And I'm happy. I came home happy, and when I came home and I looked at them, I cried. I know they want to do better. I know they do. But ain't everybody given that blessing that I was given. I was given the blessing to go up to Seattle and have people believe in me. The lady asked me my name, and I told her my name is I Need Money. Hey, for real. I told this lady I need money. She said, okay, what's your name for real? I said, I just told you, but my real name is Abram Potts. That's my real name. And she said, Abram, I'm going to get you some money. I said, no, I need money now. I don't need this stipend check. I need some money. And I'm going to tell you what this lady did for me. It's like the old slogan says, you can take a man to the river and show him how to eat, but you teach him how to fish, you tell him something a lifetime. They put me in a CNC department. I never heard of a CNC. They taught me about cutters and all this other stuff. I'm drawing pictures of these cutters that go in these machines, and I got to give them to these people to go in this machine. Then the man came down and said, hey, man, you want to run this machine? I said, you damn right I do. I don't know what I'm doing. I don't even know what they on there doing. I don't know an X, Y coordinate the first. And when I went down there and did it, I fell in love with it. And she came back. She said, I told you. I'll get you some money. No, she taught me how to fish. And I can go anywhere worldwide and get me a job. Anywhere that accept felons. A machinist, they accept felons. They don't care. They just want you to work. That's all they want. And for so many companies to say, hey, you know what? We don't want you serving for 10 years. Do you know how many people, felony people there is out here with higher degrees than some of the people sitting in this room but can't get a job? And I know some of them. I know some people that know the law at the back of their hand. They can't even go be a professor because they don't even want them. That's not right. So I'm saying, stop this. This, whatever you want to call it, stop it. Fight it. If we say we are people of society, let's be a people of society. Let's not judge nobody. Because half the people up in here then did something wrong, and you were just lucky to get by. But for some of us, like myself, I raise my hand, I did it. I did it. I took mine, I did it. And I admit full responsibility for it. They say that's the first action of becoming a man, is taking full responsibility for whatever you did wrong. I took full responsibility for it. And I won't ever doubt that. And I'm gonna keep moving forward. But if I can help with this reentry thing, if I can help with this recidivism, if I can help with saying, hey man, you know what? Get this 12% tax off a person, this interest that comes out the blue, that comes out of your check and mine, let's look at it. Because these are the effects that happen mentally. Because if a person goes right after coming home out of prison and you put this roadblock in them, what's liable to happen if they don't have support? The first thing you're gonna do subconsciously is think, I need to go back here and look at this. These things called scotomas. I don't know if y'all know, about that, but it's something in your psycho, in your mind, your subconscious. It plays a role. If many of y'all be in your office and you put a pen down somewhere, and when you put the pen down, you can't find it. In your head, you don't think, man, who done came in my office and took my pen? Right? This is your subconscious playing a role with you. Mentally, this is what happened to those who go to prison. Subconsciously, they know that, man, if things go wrong, I'm gonna go this way. And this is what they see. Stop it. And this is what I tell people I talk to. Hey, man, don't listen to that little voice in your head that say, hey, man, you know, they're against me. They're not letting me move forward. They're not letting me. No. Nobody's not letting you move forward of your own self-will. It's you who's stopping you. I owe child support. They said, man, you owe this much in child support. I said, I can't, man. I've been locked up, man. I got to owe this. 2003, they said I owed child support and took everything I had. I didn't even have enough money to pay a rent. That was $500. I went back to selling dope. They trying to get me. When it happened this time, I said, they ain't trying to get me. I need to go handle my business. I went down there with all the letters I wrote to these people while I was in prison for over 10 years and said, hey, man, we've been having contact for the past 10 years and this has been going on. Hey, man, we need to look at this. I went all the way down to Olympia. And I'm going to tell you what happened. That letter came back and said, we suspend everything but $1,000. You don't owe us nothing. But because of my free will, but because of my will and my drive to say, hey, this is this little voice in my head telling me these people are trying to stop me. No, I'm not going to let you stop me. I refuse to let you stop me. It got knocked off. Now I'm going through another situation saying, hey, man, you owe us this money, a substantial amount, a crazy amount. And I'm saying, hey, you know what? I'm not going to let you stop me. I go to work every single day to feel like what? I'm working for nothing. But you know what, though? I'm not. I'm working for something. Boeing don't accept felons. But you know what? I'm the first person in Washington State to take a pre-apprenticeship and apprenticeship and graduate. A felon did that. I did that. Abram Potts did that. You won't stop me. And this little thing that's going on right now, I'm not going to let it stop me. For what? I'm more powerful up here than what they read on paper. So, I mean, I'm just asking you guys, man, for those who have whatever power or whatever, just look into it and say, hey, you know, if we can't put a stop to this, this, and this, to let a person move forward, let them move forward. Because you never know. That next person that you let move forward may be the same person that may be vice president of your company or maybe your accountant. Maybe the one you buying a new home for and he gave you a luxury deal, he or she. Sorry if I took up too much time. Okay.
When I met with Abram the first time, we were in a coffee shop, and he looked me right in the eye, and he said, no one is going to have power over me again in my life. I'm taking my life. And I thought, I am in for a story and a half. And I want to thank Kit Burns, who was doorbelling when he was running for county council, ran into Abram, called me up at home that day and said, you've got to meet him. And I'm sure you can see why he did that. Questions?
Did I understand correctly that the interest rate on any debt owed is 12%?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
God damn, that's a hell of an investment. I'd love to do that myself. I'm earning less than 1% on my savings account. I mean, a decent rate would be 1%.
Let's just talk decent. I could get around that. Yeah, just decent.
Abram owes 56, and Heidi owed 10,000.
My brother died from cancer, so we used that money to pay it because we could see all the stories you hear when you're inside. We could see that I was never, ever going to get out from underneath it. So my family paid it for me. And I have friends now. They can't buy a house, can't buy a car, credit's all messed up. They're trying to move on with their life, but that's a lot of money to have to get pay back. And sometimes they force you, once it's sold to collections, to pay $200, $350 a month. That's a serious amount of money.
Stop.
So that would be an excellent topic of...
Yeah, you said sold to collections. Let's get this straight with Pierce County. It's not sold. This debt is not sold. This debt is not sold to nobody. Now, by federal law, it says in order for a person to collect a debt, they have to own the debt. These companies that Pierce County deal with does not own the debt. The debt is still owned by Pierce County. What they get is the interest off the debt. So when the money comes back to Pierce County that they say the person owned, they don't get really too much of nothing. They get about 2 cents. Nothing. Pierce County don't get nothing back off of this. So what's the point of having it? If the money's not going back to the county, which I don't mind paying, if you tell me I got to pay my court costs, let me pay my court costs to the people that I took from. Don't have me paying my money to another entity that don't even own a debt, but have the right to come through, garnish a person's check, harass them, and then say, you're going to owe us this much money by this amount of time, when you don't even own nothing. Where's the right in that?
Hi, my name is Helen, and I work for an organization called Emergency Food Network, and we run Mother Earth Farm, and we have a crew that comes out to work with us every year, and we decided that we were walking the walk, but we weren't talking the talk, or other way around. And so we opened up our seasonal programs to women who had the training, and the barrier we're having to hiring those women is DOC. And so I'd really like to spend some time with you later talking about this. They're saying that we can't hire the women to work at the farm because they're going to be associating with known criminals. Well, if you go work at McDonald's, how do you know what the person next to you did? I think it's actually more prudent that we know, and then we can take care of the activity. I'm also working with two women who are currently incarcerated who are getting out in March. One of them has been in the institution for 35 years. And working with her is really interesting. And like you said, she was able to get in my car one day at the farm, and I turned on the ignition, and the steering wheel came out, freaked her out. She had no idea. But the other one, part of the problem, and I'll ask you a question, is like, how do we get together to really make this happen? Because in theory, it's sounding great. In practice, it's failing. And one of the ladies who's getting out in March, I've worked with her for her resume. It's 2 weeks now, and she hasn't been given time to go down and rewrite her resume. So I applaud the two of you. I guess I'm making a speech and not asking a question.
I just wanted to say how moving both of your presentations are, and how important that you continue to use this experience that you have both had and to have these conversations. They need to happen, and it affects many, many people in this room. It personally affects us who have a vulnerable child right now. And so I just want to say how beautiful of a job you both did. Honestly, this has been one of the most moving, heartfelt programs. And to encourage you both to continue doing what you're doing, because you are going to change a structure in our legislature, and you're going to change the lens about what it's dignity and how we can wrap around each other. So thank you.
I've got a question for both of you. I looked up the laws about expungent, you know, getting rid of your criminal history. And what I found was that there are certain levels that can never, ever be expunged. And I'd just like to maybe you could just kind of throw out what you think perhaps the law should be changed to, because you could do something really, really bad. What do they call that? A class A. You could do a class A felony, very, very young, and you could have 30 years of productive life doing fabulous things, but you never could expunge that.
Yeah, and that was part of my, it was in here, but I never got to it. So if my lifespan is this long, this is how much that I spent incarcerated. I still have to spend all this with you guys, so I would think you would want to talk about actually me being free. If I did the time, when am I actually free and out from under it? I can never get out from underneath my felony. I will always have that as a label unless the law changes. I don't know how that happens, but I don't fully feel free because I still... They never remove that label from my daily things that I have to accomplish and do. That always comes up still with an unknown deadline till I expire.
Yeah. I got a quick question. I mentioned the OK Boys Ranch kids earlier, and one of the concerns I've always had is that the issue of institutionalization. And I know, Abram, you've got an incredible drive. And Heidi, it sounded like you had a great support network. A lot of the kids we see come out don't have either the drive or the network. And one of the things we've seen is this institutionalization that happens where kid comes out, can't really get any support. Right. And pretty soon winds up stealing a car just so he can go back and get 3 square meals. Right. And you talk to these guys, and you can't understand it if you're on the outside, and you think, what are you doing? Why didn't you? And they say, look, there's no money. You can't get a job. DOC's not helping us, and I need to eat. But they talk about this institutionalization where kids get, or people, not just kids, but they get to the point where they need that institution around them, and without it, they have a very hard time functioning.
It's on. Yeah, I can totally relate to that. Before my first adult crime was committed, I was at Jesse Dyson's Boys Ranch, right? And I'm gonna tell you something crazy. I didn't feel more safer and more productive out at this Boys Ranch, knowing that when I come home, ain't nothing there. There's nothing gonna be there. I'm going right back to doing what I'm doing. When I'm at the Boys Ranch, I'm working, I'm playing football. The school's like, man, the dude is phenomenal on the football field. I have structure. These kids have no structure. When it's the same thing in life. You get up, you brush your teeth, you wash your face, you know, you say, hi, honey, I'm going to work. That's your structured day. These kids don't even have that. You have to install this structure. When you're in the institution, you get up, we're going to breakfast. From breakfast, we come back. We go to rec. From rec, we go to school. From school, we go to lunch. From lunch, we come back. We sit down for 30 minutes. They're structured like this. So what has to be enabled now is this structure, a positive structure, saying, hey, you know what? There's nothing out here for you. However, this is what we're gonna build right here. We're going to put this structure. You get up, you go to school. After you get done going to school, you go to work. You go to work, you come back, you do your homework. If you got any extracurricular activities you do with the school, you do that. However, this is your system right here. The more you put the structure into these kids, the more the institutional part leaves. Now there's a support system there. You know, like I've seen kids with juvenile life. I talk to them and my heart go out to them because I know what's coming next. I can see it. This person is about to get out. Only thing that's waiting for them in them same streets, that's it. So, you know, to answer the question is structure. This is what you need is structure, man, structure based. You know, if I would have continued on that path in that boys' ranch, I know for a fact I would have been doing something different. But the thing is when you put them kids in a boys' ranch, get them out the environment. That's the main thing, the environment. If you put me in an environment in Tacoma back then, man, I'm going right back to 44th Street. That's what I'm doing. But if you put a kid in a structured environment that's healthy, somewhere out their mind frame, now you have no choice but to do right. Now what are you going to do? Now this is where we're going to really see, do you really want this or you really don't? But the whole institutional thing is structure, man. That's it.
Is it true
only of kids? No. My mom, because of her heart of what happened to me, she opened up her home to somebody that was getting out. And you could see the same wobbliness, the same indecision, inability to do anything by herself. She needed my mom very much. But then you could see after a year, she slowly became making decisions for herself. And after 2 years, flew the coop again, meaning she was able to stand on her own 2 feet. You could, and she was in her 60s. So she was fully capable of learning a new way. As soon as she was stable, the environment was safe. She was protected and safe in my mother's home. She was able to mature enough and then make her own decisions and get out. So I absolutely believe we're amazing as human beings and able to learn to shed that very real thing that is called institutionalization. Unless you're like me and every once in a while it comes back and I drive around in circles because I can't make a decision. But I attest some of that to just being told over, this is what you're doing, this is your schedule, this is, you know, that's part of it.
I'd like to add to that too, if I could. I think part of what we need to do is also deinstitutionalize the institutions. And a big part of how you can help with that is the community coming into our prisons and work releases, being involved. I'm so glad that mentorship was spoken about today because that is invaluable. And just the opportunity of planting hope as somebody comes in is sometimes what it takes for them to get out. But they have to stay connected to the community while folks are in, and it's absolutely not a phenomenon limited to children. It exists, and the way that we break that down, in addition to everything that was just mentioned, is bringing the community into our prisons.
So. I just wonder, what would be your idea of How can we provide structures to, like when you got out of the boys' ranch, what could we do to provide that structure when you were out so you wouldn't get in trouble again? If the home isn't providing it, then what? That's what I'm trying to say.
I mean, it's kind of a hard question, right? Because I was having to do this, I was used to it and I was liking it. But when I came home, that same feeling wasn't there. And it's just like I told you earlier about the scotomas. I mean, in my head, I felt like nobody's here. The same peers that were there for me, writing me letters, calling me on the phone while I'm in juvenile institution, was right there. So I'm doing the same thing again. Yeah. I'm going right back to 44th Street. I'm going to go hang out with the crew. Now, I boxed at the boys' club and up here on 23rd for years. They don't have that no more. You can't challenge a kid to nothing. You can't even go to the people center and go get a free lunch no more. You know, like, they took all this stuff away. But those were my outlets, though. These were my outlets. That boxing gym was my outlet. From the time I was 13 years old, I can box a grown man. It was no problem because I've been boxing since I was since a kid. But I had structure there. In order for you to box, you need structure. You got to get up in the morning. You got to run. You got to do your sit-ups. You got to jump rope. That was my means of structure. So for the kids right now, I mean, these homes, you're so quick to throw a juvenile on the street. I seen juveniles, they mom and daddy locked up. They don't got no structure. So the home base has to be somewhere. So if you're willing to say, hey, man, I'm willing to give a boys ranch this much money and feed them like this, okay, why can't you have another one that's predominantly for them? To say, hey, man, you know what? If you don't want to go home just yet, and you know mom, your mother and father's like this, and you're willing to abide by these rules right here, okay, we'll give you this much time to do this at a certain age. Those who got the juvenile life.
There's a gap there of getting out, but not quite ready to be out, don't have any structure in place, don't have a safe place to live, but you have to leave prison now. So there's that gap missing of anything available right there.
It seems to me that the Department of Corrections has an obligation to communicate to the public what it is that it does. And it's just never really done that throughout its history. This is a good example, but it's such a small scale that you just can't reach, you can't do anything with the public stigma for a person that's been convicted of a felony. And I noticed on the legislation that's being put forward, there's nothing in it about, there's no initiative or anything about communicating what is going on. The public, if they knew the stories of, a good example right here, just knew these stories, knew that it was something other than just lock them up and forget them. I just think that some way or another, the department has to start communicating some of the good things that it does. It has to start combating the stigma, and it has to start there. Otherwise, reentry, I'm afraid, is a really uphill battle.